This is Toon Talk Weekly, episode 239. This week, Brad and I travel the seas and try to become the best adventurers we can when we watch the series The Misadventures of Flapjack.
Welcome to the muscle.
The muscle?
You mean like the clam or the body part?
I'm afraid you're wrong on both accounts. Magical undersea lair.
Whoa!
Please, please come in and wipe your feet. Wait! You don't have to. Say hello to the Ab. The auto boot brusher. My boys tell me you have a fast whale. Is it true?
Oh, it's true. She's the fastest.
You know how I feel about bragging.
She's pretty fast.
Day just keeps getting better. Yeah. Boy.
Hey everyone, it's Tuesday once again. That means it's time for another episode of the Weekly Cartoon Podcast. Toon Talk Weekly, that's of course this show. So thank you once again for joining us to chat about some cartoons this week. I'm Jake Williams. I'm not the only guy here on this show. Brought along my good friend, Brad Chmielewski, who also just got a haircut before the show like I did. So we're connected in that way. What's up, man?
What's up? But that means nothing to the audio listener of the podcast, so...
And if you are watching the video version, you're going to be like, this guy's wearing a hat. I can't tell. Yep. So
I think it was like poofing out from my hat. That's how.
It was just such a weird like weekend that all three of us that work together in our company got like haircuts within like 18 hours of each other.
Yeah.
And didn't tell each other. It's like National Haircut Day. We literally remember to get haircuts when there's like, oh, this big football game's on. Whether you're going to watch it or not, you hear about it and you're like, I should get a haircut.
That's the time to get a haircut, yeah.
Yeah. You're never sure what's going on. So what's going on, man?
Not too much. I've just been watching cartoons, catching up on some regular show, things like that, yeah.
Sweet, dude. I haven't heard one way or the other what people are thinking of the show. The numbers still look fine to me, so... if they like the new format, but I gotta say...
Oh, our format.
Our format,
regular
yeah.
show.
No, I
heard if people are liking this regular show.
Right. But I'm loving, personally, the new format that we do, where we just kind of like... We don't talk about one episode in particular. We maybe run through a couple of them. But basically get to the nitty-gritty of them, because I find I'm actually watching more of the cartoons now.
For sure, yeah.
It's been my recent thing... That Saturday mornings, I kind of wake up, make some coffee, and I'm like, I'm just going to throw some cartoons on. And I end up watching three or four of them because I want to get a good breadth of like kind of what the show has to offer. That's always good, especially for those shows that have like pretty good fan followings, because I'm clearly not an expert and don't pretend to be. But if I can get more than one episode in, then I have a better idea of what these characters are.
Right.
And stuff like that. And I think we've had the misfortune of like, watching episodes of shows that had nothing to do with what the show's about. It was just like a one-off thing, and we're like, oh, crap, this isn't working. So, but still on my list, man, I can't believe I haven't watched it, is the other couple of episodes of Castlevania, that Netflix series.
Okay, right, yeah. And Rick and Morty, and yeah.
Yeah, but Castlevania's been on my mind recently for some reason. Like, I really want to see what happens, and I keep... What's funny is I think, damn, I should watch Castlevania. And then I also remember, yeah, Brad told me the first episode we watched sucked and the other three were good. Because, like, they actually go into the story. So that's on my radar. Hopefully by next week I won't have been a slacker and I would have just thrown them on the TV so I can actually watch them. So,
yeah, I started this new cartoon that we'll probably watch here soon, the Unikitties on Cartoon Network.
I got to look this up now. Actually, I feel like you've sent me this, and I wasn't sure if it was out when you sent it. Yeah, I've seen this.
Yeah, I don't think it was out when I sent it to you, but now there's episodes on the Cartoon Network app. So,
oh, dang, and
there's no Clarence, there's no Steven Universe. So here I am watching Unikitties.
Unikitties? Well, there are two shows that are coming out soon that I found out actually in part because of the show we're watching this week, which is the 2008 series, The Marvelous Misadventures of Flapjack. But the two shows coming up that we're definitely going to cover at some point is a show called Final Space that's actually premiering at the end of February. That's over on TBS. That just looks fun. I think when we were talking about it, you said it had kind of like a Rick and Morty vibe, like a cleaner kind of look.
Mm-hmm.
And the other show is called Close Enough, which was created by the creator of Regular Show, J.G. Quintel. And it's like a, not maybe as weird as like a raccoon and a bird being friends, but it's humans like adjusting to life being going from like 20 to 30. But the situations do get super weird and stuff. So it looks like a fun kind of like his take on like what a sitcom would be for people our age. So that show looks fun. But let's talk about Flapjack this week. The Marvelous Misadventures of Flapjack. Brad, in the pantheon of cartoons that you've watched or heard about, where is this one? Have you heard of this?
I've heard of it and I've seen it around, but I never really dove into it because it looked like the Cartoon Network version of SpongeBob SquarePants.
Oh, I get that, like the nautical feel, all the water and everything. I could see that. I actually think the show got recommended to us by a friend. I want to say our friend Jack, like at one point, a long, long time ago, brought this show up, and I didn't know anything about it.
Okay.
Just looking at some of the characters, the one character who's the captain that hangs out with Flapjack, he just reminds me so much of not the main character, not Ollie Timbers. Wait, is it Ollie Timbers? The kid from Welcome to the Wayne that like lives there, who like thinks he's a secret agent. I think that is Ollie, because I think that it's the new kid. Anyway, the character design reminded me of that when I saw it. But
okay.
So, Marvelous Misadventures of Flapjack, I mentioned earlier, 2008 series, created by Thurop Van Orman for Cartoon Network, and it premiered on June 5th, 2008. 3 seasons, 92 episodes of the show, dude, so it was on for quite a while.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, we're going to talk about the episodes mm-hmm. we watched, but did you watch any of the later episodes? Because the first few, like, that I watched, they were, you know, 4x3.
yeah, so I watched a couple from season one and a couple from season two, and they were both 4x3.
Right, so that's crazy. Like, that's not even that long ago.
Well, if you remember, though, yeah, there was that TV standard. It was, like, February 2009, when everything had to, like, go over to a digital signal.
Yeah.
Or something like that. So, yeah, it's kind of, like, looking back at video clips of even, you know, the Super Bowls this past weekend, and, like, looking at clips from games that I remember from just 10 years ago, and the footage looks awful. But you don't think of 2008 as a long time ago.
No, yeah. I think I was also clearing out like old paperwork, like taxes that mm-hmm. I needed to like, you know, pass that 5-year thing in like 2010 stuff. I was like, oh my God, that wasn't that long ago, but this is crazy. Until yeah. 2008, it's like, what?
Especially like looking at your work from 2008 and you're like, wow, this is what passed as good work then, or like work mm-hmm. that got me paid. Like, that's kind of crazy. So yeah, for 2008, yes, it was 4x3, and I will say the fidelity, because I also put up some images with the show, like our YouTube thumbnail and all that stuff, fidelity was not great. And I kept hoping, I was like, man, maybe it's like a buffering thing, maybe it's getting the full quality file. No, it's just like wasn't as high quality as crisp as you're used to. I could see maybe if you throw this up on your TV from, you know, a safe distance away, you wouldn't matter, but yeah, it was kind of crazy, but. So yeah, 92 total episodes. The series actually concluded in August 30th of 2010, so it ran for a couple of years there. Dude, it received 2 Primetime Emmy nominations, 2 Annie nominations, and 1 Golden Reel Award nomination. So it was definitely noted as a good cartoon, or it seemed to have some notoriety when it was airing. And I mentioned earlier, one of the creative directors on the show was J.G. Quintel, who created Regular Show. I believe he also animates, and I would assume also does illustration, because I gotta say, the characters in Flapjack look like the beginnings of characters for Regular Show.
Yeah, a little bit. Okay.
Like, it's something about like the pupils and some of the eye shapes and faces and what they do with some of the weird animation that it reminded me of Regular Show. But I'm not the expert. I haven't watched nearly as much as you have at this point.
Yeah, I think I'm on. How many seasons of Regular Show are there? There's like, is there 6?
I think I'm on six. So it's still airing.
Oh, there's 8 seasons. I believe I'm on season 6.
Dang. I think I binged a lot when we watched it for the podcast a couple of years ago, but that was only like seasons 1 and 2 were out or something. But that would make sense. And as I mentioned, J.G. Quintel also has a new show coming to TBS. It says sometime early 2018 called Close Enough, and we'll probably cover that show as well because it looks like a lot of fun. So the idea for the Marvelous Misadventures of Flapjack was actually pitched by Van Orman, the creator, to Cartoon Network in 2001. So it didn't become an actual show until 08. And it's funny because I guess he had an upbringing in Florida and he eventually moved to Utah, but he kept having these like dreams basically of marine adventures. He loved being by the water so much. I was reading something about stories where he just up and grabbed a paddleboard or a surfboard or something and went and tried to live on some island, but then he got really sunburned and started to starve and had to come home. Like he kept doing these things. So he's clearly attracted to this idea of this nautical adventure or something that takes place on the seas. And that influence is clearly there in the Marvelous Misadventures of Flapjack. I'll save the style comment for a little later. But what can you expect from an episode of Flapjack? Basically, the series revolves around Flapjack and Captain K’nuckles, who has kind of been appointed to mentor Flapjack along his way. Flapjack is a young boy who is raised by a whale named Bubbie. He kind of like lives in the whale and he kind of lives in the sea. There's a town called Stormalong Harbor, which is basically the main city hub that a lot of this takes place on. It's got this really cool design of this like almost like pirate shanty town on top of a dock in the middle of the ocean. There's almost no land around it. And essentially everything is centered around the idea that Captain K’nuckles is convincing Flapjack, or they're trying to go on adventures to Candied Island to get all kinds of this island made of completely out of candy, this amazing far-off place. That's the main draw.
That's our goal, yeah. But they also, candy is like a currency there, too, in this world.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy. And I would say the other goal is that generally they just want to be adventurers. They're in it for the adventure, for the journey. That as they go on, they're not necessarily worried about the destination. However, yeah, Candied Island is where they want to go. So the characters, the main three characters we just mentioned, Flapjack is actually voiced by the creator. I read something that he was supposed to be voiced by the actor who plays Pee Wee Herman, whose name is escaping me, but he didn't show up on the day of shooting or recording. So the creator just voiced Flapjack for the rest of the show. Save some money there. And Captain K’nuckles is voiced by Brian Doyle Murray, who is the older brother of Bill Murray. And if the voice sounded familiar, it's because he voiced probably the most famous thing I saw was the Flying Dutchman from SpongeBob SquarePants. So kind of the same, the gruff, piratey sounding voice to me.
Right.
And then Bubbie is the whale, also compatriot of this main group. So that's kind of what
who's
you can
the voice
expect.
Of Bubbie?
I don't know. I should have, of course.
Because that voice sounds very familiar, and I couldn't place it, and I should have looked it up as well. But it feels like a voice I've heard. Maybe not even a cartoon voice actor. It feels like a voice I've heard from another cartoon or another a real-life movie or something.
Yeah, so the voice is Roz Ryan, who's an American actress, singer, and voice actress and comedian. Says well known for her part in the television show Amen.
I don't know that.
For her character, yeah, I don't know that either. She was the voice of Thalia, the muse of it says the muse of comedy in the 1997 Disney animated film Hercules.
Oh, maybe that's where I pull it. I hear it from.
Well, you said it might have been a film, so that's clearly maybe what you're thinking of. Yeah, I couldn't really. It looks like she was somebody's mom on the show Recess in 1998.
Yeah, I don't know.
She was another mom on a Kim Possible movie.
She is a voice actress, more so than anything. Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
All right.
Interesting. She actually did one of the witches in the Looney Tunes show from the reboot in 2011. She was in Teen Titans Go. She was in Being Puppy Cat. She was in a ton of stuff, man.
Damn. Okay.
She voiced a cake in Adventure Time. Perfect.
That'd be hilarious to just tell your friends and be like, yeah, you know, I was the cake in Adventure Time. Like, okay.
I speaking of like telling your friends to like check something out, right? I go to the same barber all the time. This is unrelated to Flapjack, but I mentioned to him, he's into techno, like electronic music. And I said, oh, we finished a music video at my company for Dylan Francis and Nightmare, these two DJs that I knew he was into because he's told me about them before.
Right.
But then we had this discussion that was like, yeah, when's the last time you saw a music video on purpose? Like, it only when they're nominated for me do I see, like, oh, Kendrick Lamar had like a video nominated or something, I check it out. But like, I might stumble upon a music video, but it was funny to like lead him. I was like, well, just go look animated Dylan Francis video and you'll find it.
Because sure, but
I told him the song.
Lots of people watch videos on YouTube because of playlists. You have music playlists. You listen to music on there, and some of them are music videos. Sometimes they're lyrics. Sometimes they're just the song with a picture of a dog, you know?
Yeah. Oh, don't get me wrong. I am clearly aware that I am the unintended audience for music videos. Like, I don't catch them as much as I should. But anyway, back to the misadventures of Flapjack. So let's talk about some episodes, man. You said you had a chance to catch a few episodes. What did you watch about this show?
So I watched the first two episodes of the season, and then I watched the third episode. So I watched basically the first three episodes. Mm-hmm. I often like to start at the beginning in these cartoons, and then I almost just jumped around, but it just started playing the next one. I was like, all right, that's fine. Yeah. I just watched the first three. I don't know if you watched those or if you watched completely different ones.
Yeah, so I caught, it sounds like we both watched season one, episode one. At least this is on Hulu. I think we're both watching it there, which the episode numbers are different than what you'll find on any list on Wikipedia. So I don't know the official air date, but season one, episode one on Hulu was Several Leagues Under the Sea and Cami Island was the first two. So I caught those, and then I watched an episode from season two. So it sounds like maybe you didn't catch that one.
No, I didn't. The second episode, first part, was about them finding this like scientist that basically invented stuff under the sea, and he had invented a mechanical whale to race, basically to challenge Bubbie, who's known as the fastest whale in the sea. He's like, nope, I've got this whale. Let's race. Yeah. And the whale is pretty much powered by children.
By child slave labor, yeah. It was. Yeah.
So that was a pretty funny episode.
Dude, I will say, so yeah, that one was a pretty weird introduction to it. I saw that there were a few shorts and like a pilot, so there might have been like more of an origin story that I didn't dive into. But as for what we saw, yeah, dude, I got this feeling after that episode, I started like trying to keep tabs on it. The show's plots like are kind of okay, they're fine, like typical cartoon fare, they're kind of wacky, they're kind of all over the place, but then there's like a little bit of darkness to it too,
right? They all involve like kidnapping children
and
selling them and trading them.
So like as soon as I saw the child labor kids, I was like, holy crap, it was a different world in 2008.
I watched another one where what's the pirate's name, basically
K’nuckles, yeah,
he bets the kid in a poker game, whatever his name is. I'm like forgetting everyone's name.
Flapjack?
Yeah, Flapjack. He bets Flapjack in a card game, and he ends up winning. But Flapjack is so sad that he was placed on the like table as the bet that he basically like goes off away from the pirate friend. But the pirate guy, the guy he was playing with against also bet his child in this. So now, and then Flapjack is like so sad. He basically finds another guy and is like, "Hey man, I'll be your apprentice." And that apprentice is basically, he's a banker. So now Flapjack works at a bank, basically as his slave. And that's like weird, like kids are just slaves in this show.
Yeah, there's something weirdly dystopian about the show in a way, like the way that the town of Stormalong Harbor is like portrayed is like that there's thievery and like it's like you would expect like a pirate cove town to be or something like that, where being a thief is expected and there's no law or anything like that. And that's why like these things come off as a little bit jarring for a cartoon to be a mild-mannered plot of, like, for instance, you mentioned the first one. Oh, let's race. Oh, but also that's run by a guy who is technological advanced, but also using children to shovel coal into his alpha whale. So they get pretty dark. It's a weird, I had this weird Ren and Stimpy vibe watching this show where you sometimes get these, like, they're cute or like these exaggerated faces or something like that. But then once in a while, there's like a gross or maybe like a just a not PC sort of situation, much like the child labor in the first one, that kind of catches you off guard and you're like, I'm not sure what to think right now.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. There wasn't much of the second episode in that set was the Cammy Island one, where they stow away as some anchovies on a pirate ship because they hear
sardines,
excuse me, and they're going to Candied Island, right? But then they misheard and they get off the island. They think they're there, and they're like, actually, this is Cammy Island, and they ditch all of the sardines, and take off without them. And suddenly they realize there's this big giant on the island who is eating all these sardines. But you notice that she's eating them like plugging her nose. She actually doesn't like them at all. And it takes Flapjack to be the only person to ever realize that Cammy is a girl when she, like, subtly turns her head and there's a bow or, like, a bra strap shows.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's these small things that are, like, a little bit more adult than the show leads on that it is.
But then, like, the Cammy just wanted scrambled eggs. Yep. And they dress up like a bird to steal this bird's eggs. I felt like kind of bad for this bird.
Yeah.
Like, even because now it's like, hey, this person's tricking you and basically stealing your kids to eat them.
Yeah. Like, and you know what's funny about that scene, dude, was that was in a montage. And they did such a great job of making you feel so bad for this bird who's only in a montage of the cartoon that they spent all this time, like, having tea together, pretending to be birds and pretending to be friends. And then they make off with your babies and eat them. I think the resolution of that one was that while Flapjack was actually truly being nice to Cammy and giving her the only friend she's ever had, K’nuckles was off trying to build different rafts to get off the island.
That's pretty much his banana raft.
That a gorilla just pops out of the ocean and eats it. The scenes were great in this. The moral of that was basically talking about, I guess originally K’nuckles had told Flapjack that adventurers leave old friends to make new friends. But then when he wanted to leave, he changed his quote and he's like, actually, you leave new friends to go see old friends. And it took, in the very end, Cammy is like totally fine with it and builds them a ship to leave because he built a crappy raft that was never going to get him off this island. But Flapjack's moral or lesson was that, well, you do leave new friends to go become old friends, but eventually new friends become old friends and I'll be back to see you again. So it was was a heartwarming thing.
That was nice. But I think K’nuckles' moral of like, hey, we're adventurers. Sometimes you got to say goodbye to people. You'll meet new people. Like that, I guess, rings more true to life than anything. Like, sometimes you just move on and you go to the next thing. And you know what? There's lots of people who will be your friend out there.
Plenty of fish in the sea.
Or sardines in the sea.
Sardines in the sea, yeah. I also love the writing on that because the way they wrote Bubbie out of the episode was that she didn't want to pretend to be a sardine. She's like, nah, I'm a whale. Have fun. Although one of the pirates, there's a great quote I should toss in here, was like, they dressed as sardines to get on the ship and the pirates bought it. But then they're like, that's not a sardine. She's not even a fish. She's a mammal.
Yeah, nice. Was this the episode that I was going to do a little screen grab as well, where they're like, hey, in a world of peaches, don't ask for applesauce.
Yes. Yep. that was that one when he was deciding it was something about why Bubbie didn't want to come on the boat or something like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Or it's who is she talking to? Because he didn't realize it. Yeah.
Don't you poke me with that shovel, you rascal.
Hey, this ain't no sardine. It ain't even a fish. It's a mammal.
Bubbie!
What's the matter, honey?
Bubbie, aren't you coming with us?
Nope. Looks like I just wasn't cut out to be a fish, baby. But you and K’nuckles have yourselves a good time on Candied Island.
But...
Quit your blabbing, Flapjack! You're gonna give us away!
Bye, Bubbie.
Bon voyage, baby!
Who is she talking to?
In a world of peaches, Majani, don't ask for applesauce.
So I jumped to season two to see what the show looked like. I wondered if it was in HD, first of all. The first episode I watched was called Fancy Pants, where they're at the restaurant. There's like a restaurant slash bar candy shop on the town. I forgot the name of it. But they're just having like a regular day, and they're both taking turns relaxing as hard as they can. And they're like spilling their drinks and stuff because they keep leaning so much. But there was some leftover rope, so the store owner decided he was going to make a VIP part section. Like, he had all this extra rope, so he's like, I'm going to make ropes and make this the VIP section. And they started noticing that everybody in that section had fancy pants on. They had all these like different patterned pants and looked important and dignified and everything. But Captain K’nuckles doesn't have any pants. His character actually just has like stick legs.
Okay.
And he did have one pair of pants, but they were super gross, and he couldn't get in with those because they weren't fancy enough. So they go to the store, they try on all these pants, but he can't afford any of them because they're really expensive, and he doesn't have any money. Okay. But there is one gigantic, massive pair of pants in the store on display that say, if you fit in these, they're free. Which is hilarious, right? It's the opposite of what a store in the real world might really do, which is like, here's some super skinny jeans. If you're like super attractive or whatever, you fit in these, you get to buy it for free or whatever. These are gigantic. And he's like, I'll never fit in those. Then they meet this hot dog vendor who's selling candy covered hot dogs. And every time he eats one, he gets huge. So the story goes that he eats a ton of these candy covered hot dogs, which K’nuckles hates hot dogs, but they're covered in candy, so it doesn't matter. He gets super, super fat. He puts on the pants and gets into the restaurant, but I think eventually he just explodes and hot dogs bleed everywhere, like all over the people. And everyone's freaking out, and Flapjack has to tell people, like, it's okay, they're covered in candy, they're just hot dogs. Like, it's a super strange ending to it.
Weird, okay.
Yeah, and the B-side of that was called Cuddle Trouble. And this is a great episode. If you like when cute cartoon characters, I've seen it in, like, Adventure Time and stuff like that, try to be tough. Like, they got to be tough, especially in this show. You're going to be an adventurer. You can't be caught cuddling. They sleep in a... I guess the two characters, Flapjack and K’nuckles, sleep in a box next to the dock by Bubbie. But... And they keep talking about how, like, to be an adventurer, you got to get uncomfortable sometimes. You can't always be comfortable. However, Flapjack keeps waking up inside of Bubbie, like, cuddled up with her tongue. And K’nuckles keeps berating him for being a cuddler. Like, he's too comfortable. It even gets to the point of, like, he's telling a joke at the bar to all these, like, big, strong men. And they're like, oh, you know what's the difference between a cuddler and an adventurer? Flapjack's a cuddler. Like, calling him out.
Bubby, have you seen Flapjack? I woke up this morning and he... Whoa. What are you doing?
I don't know. The last thing I remember was sleeping in that uncomfortable camping crate.
Well, you look pretty comfortable now.
He must have come in during the night. I guess he can't sleep without cuddling old Bubby's tongue. Like a security blanket. It's adorable.
It's hilarious! You're a cuddler, Flap!
What?
A blubber-hugging cuddle jumper!
Oh, no!
There's nothing wrong with cuddling, Flapjack.
Really?
Nah, there's something wrong with
it. There's nothing wrong with it. Now get that nuzzle bug over to the candy barrel and cheer him up.
It's so he makes a lot of fun of him. They end up finding out that there's even a great scene, Brad, you would love, where Flapjack goes to the coffee shop or the restaurant and decides, I'm going to drink coffee all night and stay up. And he's got black under his eyes and everything. Like, I'm going to make sure I don't go cuddle. Like, I'm going to stay up and be as uncomfortable as possible. And he closes his eyes for 1 second. And he's like, God damn it, I'm back here. I'm cuddling. What ends up happening is that we find out that K’nuckles is actually more of a cuddler. And basically what he is doing is bringing Flapjack every night into Bubbie, cuddling, waking up before him, and then calling him out for being a cuddler. It takes Bubbie to realize that that's happening. So it's K’nuckles having an ego, wanting to be the most uncomfortable adventurer there is out there.
That's funny. Okay.
Yeah. It was a fun episode, but all the art and everything looked the same. The voices sound the same and stuff. So there wasn't a huge jump in like quality or anything. It was basically exactly what you'd expect.
It's pretty good.
Yeah, man. I don't know. This is a fun show. Did you also get a little bit of vibe? What am I thinking of? Gumball. Amazing World of Gumball vibe, where it's not real world items, but everything that's not a character or like a direct building is like heavily, heavily textured.
A little bit, but it's like, it's still hard to tell because it's all just 4x3 and I was also watching on my phone. So,
Oh, true.
You know, it's like extra small. So it's maybe some of those details in the texture and all the artwork I was missing a little bit.
Yeah. But I do know that the title animation is stop motion and they work with another studio on that. What I didn't look into was if the water was all like textured. It wasn't drawn, like painted like the actual animation was. What I don't know is if that was also stop motion and then they did the animation on top of it. I should look into like the background of this because that would be good to know, because there was a lot of this that had this. First of all, the colors were a lot of like muddy aqua, teal, brown, blue, very nautical, a lot of things. So nothing really like popped necessarily, especially Candied Island was one where there was just green everywhere. It was really hard to see a lot.
Yeah.
But the texture just has this like old storybook quality. I kept thinking of what was that old storybook with the caterpillar or something like evolving into a butterfly or something. But it just reminded me of stuff like that. That was like heavily textured for the eye to have this like thing to kind of feast on. And the actual characters reminded me a lot of modern day stuff. It reminded me of stuff like regular show, like Adventure Time, the things you would expect now, but maybe not quite refined yet because that stuff wasn't as popular as it is now. Now that's every single show kind of looks like that. So what were your thoughts on the show in general, Brett?
I liked it, and I'm sad I haven't watched more of it. I think it may become one of those shows where you could just put on, you know, having those like short 15-minute things makes it very easy to watch. I almost wish the cartoon was broken up not in AB in episodes and just like the 1-1-1, like you could just watch one and be done and then come back later and watch the next one. I think sometimes like the Cartoon Network app and the Nickelodeon app do that with a lot of shows now, but on Hulu, you know, they're packaged as this is the episode, so you should watch it. But I like the show. I think it's funny, it's cute, but again it feels like there's a SpongeBobness to it that makes me feel like it's a lesser cartoon. Like, why am I not just watching SpongeBob? But it's not. It just makes me feel that a little bit.
Definitely a different tone. I can't remember how much child labor was in SpongeBob. But that's the weird thing, is just how like dark and weird the show can kind of get.
Yeah, I guess it's SpongeBob. SpongeBob is the one getting used and taken advantage of, right? Like, he's more of the, he's like Flapjack, but if there was less of a world, like Flapjack lives in this world, SpongeBob, he lives in this world, but it's more the show is about him. Flapjack, the show, is about the world.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know, man. It's got a cool premise. It definitely, I want to watch some more, but I also feel like I'm sitting here thinking, and the show's obviously done. I'm sure the creators had their piece with it, but, and having not watched a ton of it yet, I want to know more. I want to flesh it out, and I kind of wish it had the modern, like, more modern design, more bright, more like whatever, but maybe it's not supposed to. Maybe because it's in, like, the pirate theme, and the city kind of feels like a city of, like, bandits and things like that. Like, it shouldn't be bright and colorful. The Seven Seas and Adventure aren't necessarily all pretty colors and butterflies, right? It's very much a gray area that people don't often go to. If you're going to be an adventurer and you're going to go see all these cool things, you got to break out of your shell.
You know, it'd be neat to see if someone was, you know, we have so many like great cartoons that keep coming out and everything, but if someone did something, either like a YouTube channel or someone that just took this and been like, you know what, I'm going to go into old shows, maybe it's Flapjack, maybe it's Mighty Mouse or things like that, and just do like an episode in the new style, just kind of bright colors, super poppy, and like, here you go, enjoy it. It's kind of like a fan-made episode, just showing like, here's a modern take on it. Here's what Mighty Mouse would be if he didn't have a phone booth to change into and blah, blah, you know?
Interesting. That's a funny thing. Like, even if it's not a modern style, like a different style than the cartoon originally came from.
I guess it's kind of, you know, what Robot Chicken does to some degree. They take these old toys and put them in these scenes that are very modern, but yeah.
Yeah, I'm thinking of any time, I'm pretty sure Rick and Morty had a guest episode with some artists that did the show in basically not the same style. But like, I guess that doesn't count maybe because the episode was that. There was no episode first and then the kind of remix. of it. But yeah, now that I think of it, man, I mean, you have the audio script to work off of with all the sound effects and everything, so you very much could just animate over it. It's as if you animated just the audio, right?
Right, and then you could always change stuff or grab things from other episodes if you needed to, like, them to say different things or have the plot points be a little different.
But, yeah.
It's just an idea, you know, that's a huge undertaking for anybody to do, but yeah. Still.
Well, look forward to Brad's new YouTube channel. He's decided to sleep 1 hour less a night to work on it.
Cartoon remixes.
Yeah, it's not a bad idea. But yeah, we had a lot of fun with the Marvelous Misadventures of Flapjack, but we're going to get out of here. Brad, where can people find out more about you when you're not recording this show?
So you can follow me on Twitter. It's @brad, and then my blog is digitalhitchhiker.com.
Great. Guys, go check them out over there. You can follow me on Twitter @JacobWilliams. And of course, if you want more Toon Talk Weekly, hit us up on Twitter @ToonTalkWeekly, Facebook.com/ToonTalkWeekly. We're also over on Google Plus as Toon Talk Weekly as well. Our email, you want to let us know what we should check out about Flapjack, what more we should know about it, or any of the other shows we've covered, is ToonTalkWeekly@gmail.com. And finally, the main hub is ToonTalkWeekly.com. Head over there to see any of these episodes, along with the video versions on YouTube, and you can hit those up and subscribe to us. We've had a handful of new subscribers every single week, so it's kind of like awesome that it's growing. Mm-hmm. And I like that people are listening to the show. So if you want to watch the video version too, you kind of get to see some of the clips as well in with the show. So maybe it'll add a little bit more something. And you know what they say, man, in a world of peaches, don't ask for applesauce. So that's going to do it for this week's show, but we will be back next week, as always, with another cartoon.
Take care.
About the show, visit toontalkweekly.com or follow us on Twitter @ToonTalkWeekly.